In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves to the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we can live and serve you in the newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen. Amen. Christ is risen indeed.
Transform us
and your beloved world, that we may find our joy in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is from the book of Acts. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers together with the crowd, numbered about 120 persons, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted to share in his ministry. So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these you two have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas turned aside to go to his place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias. And he was added to the 11 apostles. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the way of sinners, nor sat in the seats of the scornful.
Their delight is in the law of the Lord. And they may take promise each day and night.
They are like trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper.
It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away.
Therefore the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall be destroyed.
The second reading is from 1 John. If we receive human testimony, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God, that he has testified to his Son. Those who believe in the Son of God have the testimony in their hearts. Those who do not believe in God have made him a liar by not believing in the testimony that God has given concerning his Son. And this is the testimony. God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
You have the words of eternal life.
Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the 15th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because a servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you.
For all the women of the church, you are greatly appreciated. Now, I did a little research about Mother's Day, and I found out that Mother's Day, the origin, actually predated the Civil War. It was started by Ann Reeves Jarvis, and unlike Mother's Day, where children are taught how to show appreciation to their mothers, what actually happened was Mother's Day was about mothers preparing mothers that who were expecting for the arrival of their children. And it was actually a mother's work club. And it basically was that, preparing women who were going to be new mothers soon. It was started by Ann Reeves Jarvis of West Virginia. But then after the Civil War, it took on a little different turn. It took on a Mother's Friendship Day. And about mothers practicing friendship right after that terrible Civil War. Mothers whose some sons went and fought for the Union side and some fought for the Confederate side. Mothers reconciling with each other. Mothers becoming friends. And with that idea of mothers and friendship, I thought about my own mother. You know, my relationship to my mother changed over the years. She no longer felt so much responsibility for me. She became more like a friend to me. But she was always more than simply a friend. But she was indeed a friend, and we had, I think, a beautiful friendship. Friendship, reconciliation, these are all themes of the Gospel of John that we just heard that passage from, and also the letter of John to the early churches that was our second lesson. They're always talking about friendship, and they're always talking about oneness and reconciliation. Being one with Jesus as Jesus is one with God. He said, by this you will know that you are my children if you obey my commandment. And what is my commandment? Is that you love one another. And not only will you know that you're a child of God, but other people will also know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. Now, some people have this misunderstanding of this passage of Scripture. They think that if you love people, then you're becoming a child of God. No, that's not the correct interpretation. You are a child of God. The question is, are you going to act according to the nature that God has given you? Or are you going to fall into the illusion that causes division amongst people? Are you going to live and be true to who God has made you, his child? One is a reality. If you follow that reality of God, then you will love one another. If we live by divisions and strife, as we just heard in that hymn, then we know that we are acting not according to who we are, but rather to our false identity. You know, it's important that we love one another and practice that connection that we have with each other, because we all are connected in one way or another. Many of you know that I grew up a member of a large, very large extended family. As a matter of fact, I had 43 first cousins. 43. Most lived in a county just west of Charlotte. 43 cousins. And one day I remember walking through the campus of where I went to seminary, Lutheran Southern, Theological Southern Seminary. Walking through that campus and meeting somebody who was there and who was a pastor. And we had this conversation that he was from the county where my both sets of grandparents grandparents lived. And he had a common name that was my grandmother Robinson's maiden name. So we were talking about that, and he finally said, "You know, I don't know you, but I think we're related." And then we started going through, you know, who our grandparents were, and we found out that our grandparents were first cousins. And yeah, that made us, I guess, third cousins, or cousins twice removed, as they say. And we were related to each other. But I think if that's not a common experience that you would have, you could still say that about every stranger that you meet. "I don't know you, but I think that we are related." All people in this world are related. All people in this world are graced by the love of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. That's God's intent. That's God's purpose. That's how God manifests his love for us. And there are some people who know his love and some people who do not. And as the people of God who claim to know his love, we are to show God's love to other people and also proclaim his love so that they have some understanding. We belong to God, and therefore we understand that we belong to all people and they belong to us as well. How different would this world be if we all acted in that reality, if we all lived in that reality, that we are redeemed and loved of God. The world would be conquered not through violence or war or force, but rather the world would be conquered and given victory through the love of God that we see in his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand and confess our faith by using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and Son, who with the Father and Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge the baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Before I continue with the prayers, I'd like to make one announcement about an upcoming event on Wednesday, May the 12th. That will be the first farmers market here at St. John's that will be held in the parking lot across the street. That is from 3 o'clock to 7 o'clock, May the 12th, the first farmers market. Alive in the risen Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer instead of us. to be your fruit-bearing church. Strengthen the bonds among all Christian churches. Today we pray for the Moravian Church, giving thanks for the life and witness of Nicholas Ludwig von Zinzendorf, renewer of the Church at Nimrod. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creating God, the earth praises you. The seas roar and the hills sing for joy. Fill the earth with your love so that by their song, all creatures of land and sea and sky, burning and soaring, may call us to join with them in praise. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Faithful Savior, you conquer the world not with weapons, but with undying love. Plant your word in the hearts of the nation's leaders and give them your spirit so that the peoples of the world may live in peace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Caring healer, you forget no one and accompany the lonely. Be present with those who are sick or suffering, especially with the Ginger, Tom, Penny, Bill, Karen, and those who name before you in their hearts at this time. Provide for those needing homes or medical care, and point us toward life-changing responses to those who do these needs in our own communities. Be with the dying. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gracious God, as a mother comforts her child, you comfort us. Bless mothers and mothering people in our lives. Comfort those who miss their mothers, mothers who grieve, and those who grieve because they cannot be mothers, and those who have never known a loving mother. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gentle Redeemer, all who die in you abide in your presence forever. Remember with thanksgiving those who shared your love throughout their lives. Keep us united with them in you, in your lasting love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thanks be to God.